I'm Nick Pettit.
I'm Jason Seifer.
And you're watching the Treehouse Show, your weekly dose of internets where we talk about all things web design, web development, and more.
In this episode, we'll be talking about JavaScript languages and plugins, PHP best practices, and more.
Let's check it out.
The first thing that we're going to be talking about this week is a project from Mozilla called LLJS, or low-level JavaScript. This is a really, really interesting project that is a dialect of JavaScript that offers a C-like type system with manual memory management.
I understood some of those words.
Yeah. Well, what's interesting about it is that it compiles down to JavaScript. And if you like having types in your JavaScript and C-like structures, this will let you do that. It's right now a bit of an experiment, and the syntax is pretty interesting. There's all sorts of stuff that you can run on the site. We can't get into everything here, but interesting project. Check it out. Too much to summarize. It looks fun. If you're, you know, really, really want to nerd out with your languages, give this a try.
Very cool stuff.
Similar to CoffeeScript.
Similar. All right. So, over on Smashing Magazine, they wrote this really interesting post about this icon that I've been seeing all over the place, but I guess I've never seen anyone actually talk about it or formalize it and say, hey, this is a thing. Basically, they're calling it the responsive Navicon. And
now, is that the little icon that shows what's going on in like a mobile application?
Kind of like that, yeah. It's this little icon here that is those three little lines, and you see this in, like, you know, the Facebook app on the iPhone. You see this really just all over the place. And in some instances, you know, you'll hit this and, like, the app will slide over and you can see navigation. Sometimes it'll pop out a menu. But basically, it's this design pattern that's been developing across many different websites and apps that when you hit this icon, it will show you some sort of navigation. So I thought it was pretty cool that they went ahead and talked about it for once, you know? I haven't heard anybody else really actually formalize that. I just think it's been everybody kind of just copying.
Yeah, that's interesting because everybody does seem to use that.
Yeah, very interesting.
Cool, so we'll check that out. Next up is a project called JavaScript Stacktrace. This is a piece of JavaScript that you can include in your web pages that will give you a stack trace when something goes wrong or when there's an error in your JavaScript. This can be really difficult in certain situations where you have an error in one method in JavaScript, but you're not exactly sure where it came from. So what this piece of JavaScript does is it shows you the entire method call and stack chain of what happened in JavaScript, letting you debug things very, very easy.
So with that stack trace, it'll show you from that first line where something happened and go all the way back up and show you where it ultimately ended up.
Exactly.
Got it.
You can get this at stacktracejs.com. There's documentation and download links right there, as well as in our show notes.
Pretty nifty. So next up is PHP The Right Way, which is good because I don't want to do PHP the wrong way.
Right.
PHP The Right Way is basically just really good documentation for PHP because I think there's a lot of bad documentation out there and a lot of really old blog posts just because PHP has been around for so long. And I think it is one of the easier backend languages to get into, and there's kind of less of a barrier to entry. So a lot of people are using it, and there's a lot of documentation out there. So PHP The Right Way tries to fix all of that and just create really nice documentation for PHP. So you can go ahead and scroll through here and kind of see, you know, language highlights and everything that you would want to know.
Yeah, that's really good that it establishes some of the best practices that you wouldn't pick up when just reading the normal documentation.
Exactly.
And next up, I think everybody's excited. It's our app of the week.
Let's check it out.
Our app of the week this week is a project called Anvil. This is a free application for managing Ruby web applications on OS X. It's really nice. It's a menu bar application, and it uses the POW server on the back end to spin up sites for you. So what you do is you drop something, like you click the plus button, import your site into Anvil, and it will automatically set up a local .dev version of the site. So you have myproject.dev. Click that to turn it on, and you can go to that right in your browser. Really quick, doesn't require too much messing around with anything. And like I said, that's a free download. You can get that at anvil4mac.com.
It's pretty amazing that we live in an age where you can manage web applications from your menu bar. You know, you're just kind of surfing Reddit, and then you say, oh, I better check up on that thing. And
I better do some work.
Yeah. So next up is Verimail.js.
I saw some awesome cat pictures, though, on Reddit the other day.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
I haven't seen any.
I'll show you later.
Oh, sweet. All right. Verimail.js is basically a piece of JavaScript or a jQuery plugin that allows you to validate email addresses. Now, I know that sounds really lame, but if you've ever tried to validate an email address before...
Yeah, don't you just make sure that there's an at character in it?
Not quite, because, Jason, that could be a Twitter handle, for all you know.
Oh, that's true.
Boom.
Email me at jseifer.
It's actually really complicated to verify an email address. Well, not verify, but validate an email address when somebody is typing it into a form. So Verimail.js just makes it really easy to do that.
I think it's also cool it handles typos.
Yeah. So if you type in .cmo instead of .com, for example, it will actually say, hey, did you mean to type .com instead? And it will offer you alternatives for your typo. So pretty nice. It's very feature-rich. Has a lot more to offer than what I've seen from typical JavaScript plugins that do the same thing.
Yeah, that's really neat.
So, pretty nifty.
Next up is a website called JS2Coffee.org. I really love this. If you're using CoffeeScript, which is a dialect of JavaScript...
It's what all the cool kids are using.
All of them. And some of the not cool kids, but we let them anyway. No, so this is a really nice site. It has two panels. You can put your JavaScript on one side, and it will show you the equivalent CoffeeScript on the other side. And it works also with CoffeeScript to JavaScript. This can be pretty useful if maybe, you know, you're just learning CoffeeScript and you want a bit of a refresher on what's actually happening in the code. So check that out. That's at js2coffee.org. Super useful. Not much to say. I love CoffeeScript.
Very cool stuff. Well, next up, we have a blog post from Design Shack where they compare Zurb Foundation to Twitter Bootstrap. And I read this whole post,
These are two frameworks we've gone over before
yes,
on the Treehouse Show.
That's true.
So watch all of our back episodes before you read this post.
And then you can read this post after you've gone through the prerequisites.
Yeah.
Right? And you can basically get down to the bottom where they have the conclusion, and they say, cut the crap, who wins? And they say, it's difficult to declare a winner here. Now, I don't think there's any kind of surprise there. It's kind of like going for two or three seasons of will they, won't they romance on television, and then ultimately nothing happens. Basically, the answer is to
I saw that show.
It's all the shows, Jason.
Too many times.
Perhaps it's the Treehouse Show?
I'm not trying to get involved in this framework fight, but I've heard that Foundation has a great grid.
Yeah.
That's what the design people say.
Exactly. Yeah, I mean, there's small differences and larger differences, but basically the answer is to try out both of them and see which one you like better, because sometimes one is going to work for one project and one is going to work better for another project. The answer is it depends.
Try it on.
That's right. Try before you buy.
And that's it. We're going to end the show with a blog post on setting up the perfect developer environment on OS X, 10.8 Mountain Lion. Now, perfect is obviously a relative term. This is just one man's opinion with a blog. However, he does offer some really good advice and interesting defaults when setting up a new development environment. He goes through installing Xcode and iOS, as well as, you know, even setting your sidebar icon size to small in system preferences.
Wow.
I know.
That's detail.
But other than that, he does have a link to a really useful set of .dot files for setting up your terminal and commands, and as well as using alfred.app, which is one of my favorites. So, great blog post. Go ahead and give it a read. Again, try it on, see if these preferences fit you, and then report back.
And you can decide for yourself what's perfect.
Exactly.
So Jason, What did we learn today?
We learned that three-line icons can be very important.
All right. Well, that's it for this week's episode of the Treehouse Show. If you'd like to follow us on Twitter, I'm at NickRP.
And I'm at Jay Seifer. We want to thank you so much for watching this edition of the Treehouse Show. For show notes and more, check out our YouTube channel at youtube.com/gotreehouse.
And of course, if you'd like to see more videos like this one, you can check us out at teamtreehouse.com. Thanks so much for watching. See you next week.